And this year, I caught up with him again, and here's what he had to say about the law.
I'm feeling a bit beaten. It's sad that I don't feel as proud of my shows that I used to.
Martin Fugate performs as Lee Shannon at Hamburger Mary's. He's been a drag performer there for 15 years. But now he says he's afraid history is repeating itself.
We were shunned, persecuted in the 70s, and we hid and things like that. And, you know, it's been decades. Of course, I'm married now for 37 years. The point is, we became just ourselves and proud of it. And I would say it's regressed in a sense that it's very amazing that within a year or so, a whole culture, a whole group of people can be demonized.
This year, he says the LGBTQ community's rights are rapidly being taken away through a variety of new laws that some opponents believe are promoting homophobia and hate while restricting parental rights.
It has been devastating. I mean, just the feel of this whole situation has been that false things can be deemed true in other people's eyes.
On the other side of the debate is Pastor Demencio Barton. He says drag shows in any capacity are not family friendly and should only be for adults.
I do not believe that that is something that we should have put in front of our kids, just carte blanche, and have given open access to our families. Drag shows, I hold them with the same regard that I'd hold a burlesque show. It is not for children. If it's women half naked or naked bouncing around in front of our kids, I don't want to see that. If it's grown men who are doing it, I don't want to see that. My whole thing is, we've forgotten the importance of things like innocence.
Pastor Barton goes on to say that Hamburger Mary's has the right to operate, but he believes age restrictions on drag shows are necessary.
Regardless of the fact that I do not agree with them, I do respect their right to stand for what they believe for in the United States of America.
Demencio Barton there. Well, Newsnight's Crystal Knowles reports.
You know, got caught up in drugs.
Gregory Boykin enjoys the simple things in life, cooking for his family and raising his kids. But things weren't always this way.
Dad, yes, me in prison.
How old were you in that photo?
30.
At an early age, he fell in with the wrong crowd, and by the age of 29, he was sentenced to 8 years in prison for selling drugs.
Clean as you go.
He realized things had to change and says he wanted to start voting in elections but ran into roadblocks. Before Amendment 4 passed in 2018 with the support of more than 65% of Florida voters, casting a ballot was illegal for people who had prior felony convictions.
The people inside change. The laws and structures designed for them to fail.
Now, he says, with his rights restored, he's glad to be able to vote. But he says many others are still afraid of being arrested.
Look what they're doing. They're coming after people for voting when the government gave them the identification to vote and told them they had the right to vote.
In 2019, lawmakers passed legislation requiring that all fees and fines have to be paid prior to being eligible to vote. But as Florida Rights Restoration Coalition President Desmond Mead explains, the lawsuit they filed this year was to put the state on notice that they have to create a centralized database to let people know who is and is not eligible to vote.
This job that we're asking the state to do is to take ownership over verifying, you know, whether or not a person is eligible to vote. You know, there's a lot of talk over the years about election integrity, and we believe that election integrity starts and stops with the state or with the local government.
In 2022, the state arrested about 20 people, mostly black former felons who were issued voting cards. Some said they were told by officials they could vote and were unaware they were ineligible, either because they had unpaid fees and fines or convictions for offenses exempted in Amendment 4.
For us, it was an embarrassment, you know, that the state of Florida would resort to arresting people and charging people for something that they made the mistake on.
Meanwhile, Gregory Boykin says although he will always be judged for his past, things like voting give people like him a small sense of normalcy. Now he hopes the state will do more to help former felons become full participants in the democratic process.
Crystal Knowles reporting that health officials in Central Florida are pressing efforts to tackle mosquito-borne illnesses. The Florida Department of Health has issued mosquito-borne illness alerts in some counties, including Sarasota, where several cases of locally acquired malaria have been reported in recent weeks. The last time someone contracted the illness inside the U.S. was about 20 years ago. Crystal Knowles has been looking into efforts to prevent more cases.
Fortunately, we haven't had any here in Polk County, but we still have to be mindful of the threat and the potential of something going on.
Polk County Mosquito Control Manager Jackson Mosley and his team are continuously working on keeping the mosquito population under control. These insects are the perfect carriers of Zika, West Nile, dengue, and malaria that are transmittable to people. Currently, several counties, including Polk, are under mosquito-borne illness advisories. But three counties are under alerts, including Sarasota, less than 100 miles away, where several locally acquired malaria cases have been found.
Malaria is not a typical virus, so it is with a parasite. So we make the perfect host. And we have the mosquitoes here to do it. That's the unfortunate part. We have the correct species.
Polk County has about 47 mosquito species, and Florida has close to 90 different species, many of which play a role in the transmission of mosquito-borne illnesses. Mosley says reducing their breeding environment while in the larvae stage is the most effective way of preventing the spread of diseases. And he says his team is constantly keeping an eye out for population increases.
We set out traps throughout the county, and we monitor the species composition, what species is most active and things like that. We also treat aerial, so we have a helicopter. We are moving towards a drone pretty soon, but our helicopter does aerial treatments, and it can get wider areas than what we can do with trucks.
Experts say that malaria spreading across the state via a mosquito is not a huge concern because their lifespan is about 15 days to 30 days at most, and they can only travel about a mile or so. But what is a concern, according to Brevard County officials, is someone who's infected traveling across the state and bringing that disease to the county.
We're taking precautions just in case it does. More than likely, if it was to come here, it would be spread by somebody, a person, basically traveling over here, getting bitten by a local mosquito, and it's spreading. So the mosquito itself, with flying just, you know, mostly about a mile, give or take, it would take quite a while.
Brevard County Mosquito Control Director Joseph Fiala is always on the lookout for the next mosquito-borne illness. After all, Florida is surrounded by water with hundreds of lakes and countless retention ponds, creating the perfect environment for the buzzing, biting insects to thrive.
Basically, there are always mosquito-borne illnesses to worry about. Malaria is just another one. Now, of course, malaria is a serious one, but we also have some other serious local diseases. So there are a lot of mosquito-borne illnesses that we worry about every day.
First tonight, Crystal Knowles takes a look at the arguments for and against Florida's new immigration law.
Hi, welcome.
We're still suffering the inflation from COVID. So now you put on top of that, the products are being more expensive.
For the past 5 years, Nancy Alva has managed a small restaurant. She says Latin flavor in Brevard County barely survived the pandemic. Now, Alva believes Florida's new law targeting unauthorized immigration will hit agriculture, creating a financial ripple effect throughout the economy and hurting small businesses like hers.
Products will not be available as before because farmers are leaving. That puts a lot of pressure on us to keep up working, to keep our business going. As a regular person, I go to the store and I find that the products, they don't have that good quality as before. And the other thing is they were more expensive.
Even before Florida's new law took effect, the agriculture industry had long complained about a labor shortage.
The single biggest issue we face is the unprecedented shortage of domestic labor and the restricted access to a H-2A guest workforce.
Florida accounts for the largest share of visas issued under the H-2A program for seasonal work lasting less than a year at a time. Some in the agriculture industry complain the program is expensive, time-consuming, and inflexible.
There are no American workers willing to do these jobs. In fact, American families are the ones being adversely affected as our workforce crisis will continue to drive food prices even higher.
Adam Lynch from L&M Farms addressed a U.S. Senate committee hearing on the issue in May.
The H-2A program is currently our only option. The program is greatly flawed and made even more challenging by the federal agency entrusted to administer it. With a volatile wage structure and program restrictions such as seasonal need, which does not work well in this era of modern agriculture.
Florida's new law mandates all businesses with 25 or more employees verify the status of their workers through the federal E-Verify system or face hefty fines. The Migration Policy Institute says Florida is home to more than 750,000 undocumented immigrants and predicts the new law will impact the service industry. Nancy Alva says those effects are already being felt in places that rely on tourism as workers leave the state.
They have a lot of employees that unfortunately they're undocumented because they can pay less, even though it's incorrect, they will pay less amount of money. And the owners of those hotels and resorts are very concerned.
Governor DeSantis has made immigration a key part of his presidential campaign. He's touted Florida's new law as a model for the nation.
What you want to do is say there's not benefits for coming illegally. You're either here as a native or you come legally, and those are two fine things, but to come across the border and end up getting benefits in Florida, you know, does not make sense.
Republican State Representative Randy Fine says undocumented people should not get a free pass to work. He says laws should exist to protect American workers.
If there's a problem with our immigration policies, then we need to deal with that. But we shouldn't be saying, don't do laws. I need to operate a criminal enterprise in order to make money. Because that's what people are doing when they're knowingly hiring illegal immigrants. That's not the way. I was an entrepreneur for 22 years. I didn't make my money by breaking the law. No one should.
Randy Fine, rounding up that piece from Crystal Knowles, has been talking with one of those who's trying to get abortion access enshrined in the Florida Constitution. Crystal.
Yeah, right now everybody's awaiting to see what the state Supreme Court decides, but Planned Parenthood is fighting to get the issue onto the ballot next year. They told me they collected almost 500,000 state-verified signatures so far out of the required 891,000, and they're confident they will reach their goal. Now, Stephanie Lorraine Pinheiro from Florida Access Network shares her story on what led her to become pro-choice advocate and doing that work today, and how she believes Florida as abortion laws will create lifelong ripple effects for women in the state.
Our bodies and our lives are not bargaining chips, and I feel like that's how we get treated.
Stephanie Lorraine Pinheiro is referencing the U.S. Supreme Court's decision to overturn Roe v. Wade, as well as the current debate in Florida surrounding the 15-week abortion ban and the pending 6-week abortion ban this year.
Let's see. Oh, there you go. Oh, it's over.
Pinheiro serves as the executive director of Florida Access Network, an organization committed to supporting access to abortion services. It provides various forms of assistance, such as financial support for transportation to appointments and help with clinic payments. With the private donations received, the group assisted 1,300 women this year.
And by the time people reach us, they're very clear about what they want to do.
Pinheiro can relate. She made the same decision when she was just a teenager. She grew up in poverty with parents who did not speak English and was the oldest of four children. She had to mature more quickly than most and take on added responsibilities at a young age.
I will be put on the ballot, hopefully.
I discovered I was pregnant, and it was because it was sexual assault.
She did not want to raise a child while still being a child herself. She told her parents, who reluctantly took her to get an abortion. Pinheiro says if the state Supreme Court upholds these abortion bans, the lifelong repercussions would be felt for generations.
There is a world in which 17-year-old girls like me don't have other options. There will be people who are left behind who are going to continue pregnancies that they don't want, potentially have complex pregnancies, potentially die, potentially self-manage their own pregnancies successfully or unsuccessfully.
Crystal Knowles reporting that.